What are you talking about? Risk to bystanders today. Thank you. Thanks. Oh, yes, and I heard about it.
Yeah. So thank you very much. I need to apologize because unfortunately I had a motorcycle accident just before my trip to London. I'm not at all satisfied by my presentation. It was very hard to do it. I'm sure some people will be relieved, like the chair here, because I'm not very compliant on the time limits. But Anne, I will have to disappoint you. It's 45 slides again. So. That's my conflict of interest statement. No funding from the evil tobacco, no funding from the holy pharma. My presentation is both about direct effects of users and passive exposure. So I'll start with the exposure to the consumers, and basically what they are exposed to are propylene glycol, glycerol, nicotine. I didn't include water inside. And the contaminants or thermal degradation products in the e-cigarette liquids. So I'm going to start with PG, which is basically a synthetic compound, not naturally present. It has been approved by the FDA for use in food, tobacco, and pharma products as an inert ingredient. And it has been it has received a GRAS status since 1982 for ingestion, and that's very important. And also for IV use, because in many intravenous medications, they use propylene glycol as an excipient. Now, it is metabolized by normal metabolic pathways, basically in the citric acid cycle, so we have no issues when propylene glycol is absorbed. And we have some extensive research about inhalation of propylene glycol long time ago, in the 40s mainly and the 50s. And this is Robertson, a professor from the University of Chicago, who has done extensive research on that because his main dream was to be able to disinfect the air in the hospitals or in the houses by using propylene glycol vapors. And he has done extensive studies, that's a small number of them, and he found that PG, not only him, others too, but that PG has bactericidal and bacteriostatic properties in vapor form. And they started by observing that they were protective against influenza and common cold infections, not only in animals, but also in humans, including kids. In his attempt, he decided to test the safety of inhaling propylene glycol vapors. So in 1947, he did a study exposing continuously to an atmosphere saturated with PG vapor. For 12 to 18 months of several animals, and they found no adverse effect after examining all organs histologically, including the lungs, compared to the control animals. And more recently, another study in rats found, again, no toxic effects, some slight elevation in mucin production in the nasal turbinates. That was because of the well-known dehydrating effects of propylene glycol. If you ask a vapor, they will tell you, and we have also seen that the most common side effect is dry throat and dry mouth. And a study which is relevant to propylene glycol aerosol exposure, but in the industry, in aviation industry, because it's the most common component of de-icing solutions, they tested that in very high concentrations, but only for 1 minute exposure. And they found some acute ocular and upper airway irritation in those non-asthmatic subjects, some smokers, some non-smokers. There was some reactive cough. As for the airway obstruction that is mentioned here, they found this decrease of forced expiratory volume in 1 second from 133% of predicted to 102%, so that's basically normal again. They found a statistically significant increase in the ratio of forced expiratory volume 1 to forced vital capacity. This is a ratio identifying obstructive lung disease, but I think that that finding is clinically irrelevant because it was driven by an increase in forced vital capacity. And there is no disease condition which causes an increase in forced vital capacity. It's either reduced at the same amount as forced expiratory volume in 1 second, and that's a restrictive lung disorder, or it probably remains the same and forced expiratory volume in 1 second is decreased, and that's basically the main characteristics of obstructive lung disorder. So I don't think that this finding is clinically significant, but I think that this has been used by the European Union to justify a classification of PG as a respiratory irritant. I think it makes no sense. And for another reason that it makes no sense is that they used the aviation solutions, which are industrial grade and not pharmaceutical grade propylene glycol as we have in food products or in electronic cigarette liquids. Glycerol, we call it VG, it's glycerol. It's an alcohol like propylene glycol. It's not a lipid. It doesn't cause lipoid pneumonia. It's impossible for this to happen. It's a natural compound, which is, of course, an essential compound for living organisms. It has been approved by the FDA for use in food or pharmaceutical products, and it has received GRAS status long time ago, basically at the beginning of the whole program of GRAS status for ingestion again. And again, it is metabolized through normal metabolic pathways. There is nothing strange happening. We have very limited data on inhalation of VG. That is basically one study of 2 and 13 weeks inhalation, and they found some minimal or mild squamous metaplasia at those very high levels of continuous exposure in the larynx, nothing in the lungs from inhaling aerosolized glycerol. Now, I don't know what this square is, but that's the problem so far. Now, the cardiovascular effects of nicotine, I wasn't sure if there would be any overlap with Neil. Hopefully, there's not a strong overlap. But we know that it has positive chronotropic and inotropic effects. I know that what that square is. You're going to see it later. It raises blood pressure and heart rate. So it could also be arrhythmogenic because of the sympathetic nervous system activation. We know that these hemodynamic effects are temporary, and smoking is currently not considered a risk factor for the future development of hypertension. I would say that, on the contrary, there are many studies, epidemiological studies in the literature, showing, and this is now why I need the square, that smoking cessation is a risk factor for the future development of hypertension. So in normotensive smokers, some of them quit, some of them continue to smoke. After 1 to 3 years and more than 3 years of quitting, they had a higher chance of developing hypertension compared to people who continue to smoke. Of course, that's not a reason to tell someone to keep on smoking. The combined effect of smoking and hypertension multiplies the risk for cardiovascular disease. That's only one example. There are other examples. It's somewhat not very well defined what's going on. Even in cases where they adjusted for the weight gain that we observed when quitting, they still found an independent effect of quitting on increasing the risk of hypertension. Some other studies found otherwise, so it's still a matter of debate. It's a very complex mechanism of developing atherosclerosis. It's similar to what Neil said, and I totally agree with him. And there are some studies which try to evaluate what's happening with nicotine and its association with cardiovascular disease, not in a combustible form, and that's important, because with smoking you have the combustion, so you cannot really differentiate the effects of the combustion with the effects of nicotine. So there are some studies on cardiovascular outcomes from people using NRTs, and you can see here that there was no, although there were some baseline differences in the population, in the 1 year outcomes, just 1 year, death, myocardial infarctions and so on, there was no added risk from NRT use compared to the control group. Another meta-analysis on the cardiovascular effects of smoking cessation pharmacotherapies, all of them, you can see that there were some higher rates of cardiovascular events, not major adverse cardiac events, but all types of events. But that was basically driven by very low risk events, typically tachycardia or ectopic beats, which don't seem, if it's just ectopic beats or sinus tachycardia, doesn't seem to increase the long-term risk for developing disease, unlike other forms of arrhythmias. Now, snooze is also providing very strong evidence about the effects of nicotine. As Neil said, Scandinavian snooze, a lot of data, many decades of use among males. several meta-analyses showing that here a protective effect for all types of first acute myocardial infarction, an increased effect here, a trend, but that's very consistent, as Neil said, for fatal acute myocardial infarction compared to smoking, which has a very strong effect both on all myocardial infarctions and on the fatal cases. Now, other pooled analyses, the same things, despite even when you were assessing people with who were using a lot of snooze, more than 7 cans per week, or were using snooze for many years, more than 20 years, there still was no added risk compared to non-smokers, non-snooze users. So that's important. Basically, that's based on the results of that study, the authors said that they believe that toxic components other than nicotine appear implicated in the pathophysiology of smoking-related disease, and that's because, as Neil said again, snooze users are obtaining the same amount of nicotine, in some cases even higher levels of nicotine daily compared to smokers. And another update, stroke also, no effects on any types of stroke, whether it's ischemic, hemorrhagic, unspecified, 130,000 participants, snooze users versus non-users of any tobacco product. Meta-analysis, no differences, but as Neil said, there is a consistent, as you can see here, increase, not always statistically significant, but it's noteworthy that every time you have the increased risk of fatal cases, that's an issue. Why do I think that this is happening? I think that nicotine does play a role in this. It's not a chance finding. And we know that in acute myocardial infarction, when you have an acute sympathetic activation, like what nicotine does, then you have a high risk of arrhythmias. It's arrhythmogenic. Exercise also does the same thing. So when you exercise, you have an acute sympathetic activation. And you know that during an acute cardiovascular event, exercise is an absolute contraindication. And many people who develop a myocardial infarction, the acute myocardial infarction during exercise, they die immediately almost. And that's because most likely, I mean, that's my interpretation, because of this sympathetic activation, which makes the whole condition very arrhythmogenic, and people who die from myocardial infarction, they don't die from the infarction, they die from arrhythmias, from these acute events. So I think that this is the reason why you are seeing a lot of fatal myocardial infarction cases in subjects using snus or maybe any other form of nicotine compared to people not using this these products. And I think it may be at least partly explained by the sympathetic activation caused by nicotine intake. Flavorings. There are many types. Natural, many people think are the best for e-cigarettes. That's totally wrong, but that's another discussion. Nature identical, artificial. All these flavors, almost all, because tobacco extracts are not don't have a grass status for ingestion. So many tobacco flavors who are using tobacco extracts, they have not been approved for ingestion. But for all other cases, usually they have grass status for ingestion again. Of course, not evaluated for their safety when inhaled. It doesn't necessarily mean that they are harmful, but it also doesn't necessarily mean that they are harmless. And we have cases of chemicals which are perfectly safe to be ingested, but there are several reasons of concern when you inhale them. That's diketones, diacetyl acetylpropionyl, which can cause bronchiolitis obliterans or even non-specific lung dysfunction expressed as reduced forced expiratory volume in 1 second. And I think we should eventually go to inhalation-specific flavors, but it's going to take decades. It's not something that can happen from one day to the next. There are some established limits here for from several organizations for diacetyl and acetylpropionyl, but usually they address the working environment where during the production of these chemical sort of flavors. And then we're moving to thermal degradation, which is a very serious issue and a lot of research on thermal degradation. Of course, we know that propylene glycol and glycerol can be oxidized to form aldehydes. mainly formaldehyde, acetaldehyde, and there are studies showing that depending on the equipment, this is a very old CE4 device, you can see that the formaldehyde per gram of liquid consumed is in milligrams range, but you can see in another device that the levels are 100 times less, so there is some variability. Of course, in this case, in almost all conditions, they were overburning the coil. They didn't check for that. In this case, it's most likely they didn't overburn the coil. Many studies, this is our study, where we differentiated between normal and dry puff conditions. So here are the dry puff conditions, and here with atomizer 2. And you can compare with an atomizer 1, which at the same power setups was made in a way not to generate dry puff conditions. You see that there is a huge difference. Once you get to the dry puff conditions, you get huge increase in aldehyde emissions. Even for atomizer 2, when it was vaped at lower power settings, it was everything fine. But you see that in most cases, even in normal conditions, there is some low levels of aldehydes being produced. Formaldehyde mainly, acetaldehyde also at those high power settings. Not usually acetone, not acrolein, very low levels. And of course, dry puffs, as I said, will increase aldehyde formation. But what about flavors? What's their effect on aldehyde emissions? So there was very recently, a week ago, a study which was published in Environmental Research and Technology, it's an ACS journal, which found those huge levels of aldehydes. I'm talking huge, that's 7 milligrams per gram of liquid consumed. This level means that if you consume 1 gram of liquid per day, 1 milliliter, you're getting about 4 times higher levels of formaldehyde compared to smoking 20 cigarettes. So on a daily basis, an average user of 4 milliliters of liquid, 20 times higher levels of formaldehyde exposure compared to smoking 20 cigarettes. I think that there is something wrong in this study. First of all, you cannot discuss about dry puffs for a single reason. They also tested an unflavored liquid and they found zero aldehydes at the same conditions. That's the second problem. You can't find zero aldehydes when you test unflavored liquid because it is already well established that PG and VG generate aldehydes. There is even a study using a radio-labeled PG and VG, and the authors, John Lauterbach, they found radio-labeled formaldehyde and acetaldehyde, which by definition means that PG and VG are the sources of these aldehydes. I'll make a comparison of the coffee flavor used in that study, and the coffee flavor we used in probably the worst e-cigarette you can find today, which is a CE4 atomizer. This is the replication of the New England Journal of Medicine study, a research letter on hidden formaldehyde. We did that. So this is what the latest study on flavors found on a coffee flavor. This is what we found from a very bad atomizer in normal, non-dry puff conditions, so normal conditions. This is on the first power setup when the vapors identified dry puff conditions. So from 7 to 8 watts. And this is what happens at 5 volts in that New England Journal of Medicine study, which I never even dared to ask anyone to take one puff here, and these are the levels. So yes, theoretically, you can get that high levels, or even more, but it happens only with dry puffs. Don't tell me it's time. Oh my God. You said that I'm going to talk about passive vaping. I haven't said anything. Anyway, I think that there are many reasons why this is a problem. Also, here they found acrolein, but then Peter, where is Peter Hayek? He's going to say, well, we didn't find any acrolein exposure to cigarette vapor, so how can they find acrolein in the vapor? Anyway, we're going to see about that. About passive exposure now, yeah, I'll be very fast. Yeah, okay. There is some passive exposure to e-cigarette by e-cigarette use. Here in the house is where one of the members of the house were vaping. They found some nicotine levels, much higher in those people compared to people who lived in a smoke-free, vape-free house. But of course, that's the difference between passive vaping and smoking from another study of the same authors in terms of cotinine levels. And this means that you get about 25 micrograms of nicotine per day. And according to some EU data, the lowest observed adverse effect level for nicotine, which is just a slight elevation in heart rate, is 260 micrograms intravenous administration of nicotine. So basically, you don't have any kind of biological effect from being exposed to 25 micrograms per day for one day. PM size, I think that all these discussions shouldn't happen. Not all PM are the same. PM of environmental pollution and smoking is very different of PM of boiling water, for example, which is a very small particle, to be honest, or from e-cigarettes, which is micro droplets of PG, VG, and nicotine. So what matters is the composition, and of course, if the composition is harmful, the low PM size and the high mass will cause harm. Formaldehyde, you see that even before starting using the e-cigarette, you had a slight elevation of formaldehyde. That's because humans exhale formaldehyde normally. There was no further increase, the same rate. And when you smoke, you have this sudden increase in the environment. There are some metal emissions from e-cigarettes, but when we compared the levels with the established limits, the ratio was overwhelming. I mean, much lower than what is considered safe. And we expect that because this is what a vapor exhales. 99.95% of what the vapor exhales when he takes a puff is water, PG, VG, and 0.05% nicotine. And that's why you don't have any emissions in the environment, with the exception, of course, of PG and VG. And we discussed about that. And I'm concluding. For e-cigarette users, I would say that the e-cigarettes are probably not harmless. There is a much lower level of risk. And I think that's why they are a perfect harm reduction approach, although the ideal thing is to quit by yourself or with the medications without using any alternative products for long term. For passive exposure, it's mainly PG, VG, and nicotine, considering that there are no real concerns, but we need, of course, more studies about PG and VG exposure. I doubt that there is any reason for concern right now, based on current evidence for passive exposure. I think that any decision for a universal ban, because you can look at it on specific cases, but for a universal ban, I think it's an abuse of the precautionary principle, with the added unintended effect that you are going to expose vapors to the harmful effects of passive smoking inside the airport, for example, when you will tell them to go to the smoking box, and you will give the wrong message to the smoker that e-cigarettes are of similar risk to smoking. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Excellent. Thank you very much, Konstantinos. I feel so bad creeping up on you like that, but I do want to make sure...